So I'm sure you've seen The Social Dilemma by now, a Netflix documentary talking about social media and how platforms like Facebook, Instagram, and even YouTube are designed to keep you on the platforms for as long as possible and even gather information on you. Now, I used to work in social media, so I'm familiar a bit with how algorithms work, but the documentary got me thinking about how addicting social media can be, especially for students when we want to stay up to date with what's going on in the world and stay connected with other people. Now, it is possible to maintain a healthy relationship with your social media while keeping some distance from it. And having that healthy balance would be really good for increasing your productivity and also taking care of your mental health. So today I wanted to share a few strategies for cutting down on your social media use while still being able to use the platforms in more of a healthy way. Obviously, there's way more complicated stuff I can get into, and I can talk about things like disinformation, media literacy, mental health, and all of that in later videos, but today I just wanted to share a few strategies for you to start the journey of cutting back on your social media use and introducing you to the world of digital health, if we want to call it that. So let's just jump into it. So throughout the years, I notice an interesting trend. When I'm with friends or other people, I'll notice that as soon as they hear a phone buzz or they hear a ping, they will reach for their phone automatically. It doesn't matter if we're out for dinner, it doesn't matter if we're sitting down and watching a movie, or if we're just having a brief conversation. As soon as you hear the buzz or the ping, you reach for your phone as fast as possible to see what's going on. Even for myself, I noticed this over time because I wanted to stay up to date with what was happening with other people. So if somebody sent me a message, I wanted to be the person that could respond quickly. Now, phones set up their notifications to do exactly this, to make sure that you reach for your phone as soon as possible when something happens. Now, the problem with this is that it can turn into conditioning. So basically, if you get that ping or buzz, you're gonna stop what you're doing and go grab your phone, which, as we know, isn't exactly the best thing for productivity or just paying attention to what's in front of you. I think we've all been in the scenario, or at least heard of the scenario, of sitting at a table for dinner with friends and everybody just scrolling on their phones. It's not exactly the most fun dynamic. So the first strategy is to turn off your notifications. Now, what notifications you turn off are really dependent on you and your priorities. For example, I don't need to know what's going on Instagram or Snapchat or anything like that every second, so I turn off my notifications there. But I want to make sure that I am notified if I get a text or a phone call, because in those cases, they may be more time sensitive. What I typically tell my friends is that if you want to reach me, make sure you send me a text or just call me, because I'll be able to respond much quicker. If you send me a message on Instagram or Snapchat or Facebook Messenger, I'm not going to get to them because I have those notifications off. Now, to do this is simple enough. You just head to your phone settings and go to either the notifications or the app settings and find the different options for you, and then turn your notifications off one by one. This way you can pick which apps you want to make sure you get notifications for. Like I said, text or phone calls. Maybe you need a calendar. Maybe you have a habit tracker. It really depends, but find the apps that you feel you need to have notifications on for, and then turn off the rest of them. So for a lot of social media apps, timelines, the feeds, or the algorithms are designed to keep you on there as long as possible. And they do this by showing you more and more content that you're more likely to engage with, which can inevitably lead you to seeing content that isn't exactly the best for you, but is likely to get a rise out of you. If you've seen The Social Dilemma, you'll know what I'm talking about because they have a few skits on there. But the idea is that algorithms will show you a bunch of things to see what you're likely to engage with, and will try to show you more things that aren't gonna be the best for you, but might get that sort of reaction out of you to keep you on the platform. You can combat this by being very intentional with what you follow and what you engage with. Now, every platform is a little bit different, so figure out which platforms you use and how they operate, and then change your strategy to reflect that. So for example, on Instagram, I unfollow accounts that aren't serving me in any way or aren't enjoyable. And then I specifically follow accounts that are beneficial to me. And those are focused on subjects that I'm interested in or are related to my sort of work and life. I'm much more interested in politics and advocacy, so I follow a lot of accounts that revolve around those. But I specifically avoid any of those sensational news accounts that aren't exactly the best things for you, and are often pretty biased and don't really put out a good message anyways. Instagram has a cool feature called muting, so you can actually keep following an account, but you won't see any of their posts or any of their stories. I do this for people that drive me up the wall, but if I unfollowed them, it would be a huge argument. For TikTok, I typically stay on the following page instead of the For You page, and I do this that way I can only see content from people that I follow. This allows me to stay up to date with people whose content I enjoy, and also my friends' content as well. And then also, I only watch the videos that my friends send me. This tactic might seem counterintuitive, but for those of us who want to stay using certain platforms but develop a healthier relationship with them, this is a good strategy for leveling the playing field there. many new smartphones have a feature where you can lock certain apps for a certain period of time. Or if you've used an app for a longer period of time, for example, an hour or 2 hours, you can have it set so that way when you pass that time, it locks automatically. This is really helpful for setting a hard line for how often you use apps each day. I'm sure we're all used to scrolling on Instagram or on TikTok and then looking at the clock and realizing we've lost about an hour and a half. So this feature is really helpful for combating that. Now, different phones have a different format than this, so you're gonna have to do some digging. So go into your settings and see if it's available for you. For my phone, it's called Digital Balance. Basically, what I do is that I will go in and set limits on how often I can use certain apps throughout the day. So for most of my social media apps, I have it set for about a half an hour. So if I go longer than 30 minutes on that app, it will lock automatically and I will have to punch in a password in order to use it. This way you can specify which apps you want to keep on for a longer period of time or even have no limit on, and then certain apps you might want to have less time on. My social media apps, I only give a half an hour for. Spotify has free reign all day because I like listening to music. And then same thing with YouTube and text and phone calls as well. Another cool feature is that after a certain period of time, your apps can lock, and then that signifies that maybe it's the end of the day and you should go wrap up and do something else. So for example, you might set 9:30 or 10 o'clock, and then after that time passes, all those apps you have set to lock will lock, and then that tells you that it's time to go to bed or go wind down for the day. A pro tip for using this, if it gives you the option to set a password, definitely set one. That way it sets a barrier for you if you have the tendency to try and unlock the app to keep using it. If you're going to set a password, make it long and complicated. Use a mix of letters and numbers. Don't make it something you can remember. That way, if you want to use the app, you have to punch in the password and it's a whole nuisance and it makes it less likely that you'll keep doing that. Or you can give your phone to your friend and have them punch in the password. So that way, if you need to use the app, you have to text or message them and tell them why you have to use it, and they can determine whether or not to give you the password. In this case, you can exempt certain apps, so you might exempt your text or your calls. So those are three strategies for reducing your social media dependency and developing a healthier relationship with your social media apps. It can be really easy to get sucked into this chaotic world of social media, especially because apps are almost always designed to keep you on there as long as possible. And that's true even of YouTube. So applying these strategies can be really helpful for cutting back on the amount of time you spend on these apps and give you more time to focus on the things that you want to. Spending time with friends, working on whatever you have to, and just having a healthier relationship with the things that you use. Each strategy has some pros and cons, so I suggest starting with one, getting used to it, and once you're more used to it, adding in the other later. Okay, I hope this helps when it comes to using your social media apps. There is a time to be using them, and then there's also times to put them away and focus on something else. And I hope these strategies help you set more of a hard line between those and develop a healthier relationship with your social media. This is also a sign to get off of YouTube and go do something else. That's it for me. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like. If you hated the video, give it a thumbs down. Either way, let me know what you think. If you have any suggestions on how you balance your digital health, leave a comment below and share them. Other than that, thanks for tuning in, and I will see you in the next video. Take care.